So we are going to start with probability. Okay, so probability that is going to come for your competitive exam, that will also include the topics that you have done in class 11th. Okay, so in class 11th, what are the two topics in probability that you had done? Of course, we had talked about events, the types of events, and we had majorly talked about the use of permutation combination. So the use of PNC in counting, in finding the number of favorable events and the number of events in the sample space, right? Because normally we require that in the classical definition of probability, because probability of an event is nothing but number of favorable events associated with that by total number of events, isn't it? This was done in class 11th. In class 11th, we had also covered up the concept of addition theorems. Just a second, I think. Sorry, the power was fluctuating. So addition theorems of probability. If you recall, we had done something like PA union B, PA intersection B, sorry, PA complement intersection B complement. That means De Morgan's, sorry, the De Morgan's theorem, etc. Okay, so addition theorem of probability was done. In fact, today's session also I will begin with few basic questions just to test your understanding about these two concepts. Okay, so what are we going to study in 12th? Okay, and the 12th part is the major part of your probability topic. In 12th, we are going to stress upon independent events. We are going to talk about conditional probability. Conditional probability. Okay. Conditional probability is the main thing of class 11th. Sorry, class 12th probability. This is the major topic. Okay. Everything is revolving around conditional probability for you in class 12th probability chapter. So other concepts that will be taught in class 12th would be the aiding concepts to this concept. So this is the major concept. So even the topics which will be, I'll be listing down in some time, they will also be associated in conditional probability. Okay. So we'll be talking about conditional probability. We'll be also talking about conditional probability in sync with multiplication theorem. Okay. So this will be in sync with, along with multiplication theorem. Okay. Post that, we are going to talk about law of total probability. And finally, the application of conditional probability, which is in Bayes' theorem. So Bayes' theorem is nothing but it's basically a conditional probability only. Okay. We also call it as a reverse probability. Reverse probability. Okay. After having done these topics, there is one small part left, which is called PDF, probability distribution function. Probability distribution function. Distribution function. Okay. For random discrete variables. Discrete variables. So under this, we are going to study binomial probability distribution. Binomial PDF. This is the important one, by the way. However, I think last year from CBSE, they had excluded this part. And we'll also talk about Poisson probability distribution briefly, very briefly. Okay. So this will be our agenda for this topic. As you can see, there's nothing much. Okay. I think 5 topics. And these are all revision topics of class 11th. Okay. Now, just to begin, how many of you are comfortable with the use of PNC and how many of you are comfortable with the use of addition theorems? Mostly everybody. So should we start our discussion with a problem which will test you on these concepts? Okay. Very important topic, by the way, for KVPY. If you are a KVPY aspirant, very, very important topic. Okay. KVPY loves asking questions on PNC. Probability, etc. Okay, and this time also, if you see the JEE advanced paper, ideally you should not be looking at it because you should be taking it as a test. Okay, lot of questions on probability have come, especially in paper. I think paper one, lot of paper questions on probability has been asked. Okay, anyways, let's get started. So I'll begin with a few questions just to check your understanding of probability. Okay, let's begin with this question. So the question says two distinct numbers A and B are chosen randomly from this set. Set has all powers of 2 starting from 1 till 2 to the power 25. Find the probability that log b to the base a is an integer. Find the probability that log b to the base a is an integer. I will launch the poll as well. In fact, if you're done, you can put your response on the poll as well. Again, I'm not teaching class 12 topic here. I'm just testing you on 11th concepts. Very good. Within, I think, 45 seconds, somebody has already responded. Great. Very good. Two people responded. Raghav, any updates on how Prakul is feeling? Is he fine? We spoke very briefly over a call because I was in the middle of a session. Yeah, he said that he has got an occult fracture. Yeah. So again, I'll repeat once again, since everybody is here, please do not indulge in any sports where you can fall down, you can fracture your bone or anything hits you badly. See, it's not like you'll not recover, but you are now at a very critical junction of your life. A lot of exams you are going to write, one after the other. So health is wealth. Be healthy first. Be in a sound frame of mind first. Then anything else will follow. Sincere request. Okay, we'll wait. We will keep the poll on for the next 30 seconds. If anybody wants to respond, please do so. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. If you want to take a guess, if you want to take a call, okay, just a wild guess, you can take that. Okay, not many people are responding. So, okay, 18 of you have responded so far. And out of that, half the class says it's option B. Or half the people who have voted say option B. Let's check. So first of all, read the question carefully. The question says you have to select two distinct numbers. Distinct. So you have 25 numbers and you have to select two distinct numbers. So let's say A and B. Okay, so A and B you have to select. So this can be selected in 25 ways and this can be selected in 24 ways. And this combination gives you 600. That is nothing but the sample space. Okay. Now, if you see, you want to select such A and B where your favorable event gives you a situation where log B to the base A is an integer. So let's say you select B as 2 to the power of, let's say, X. Okay. Because all the numbers here are of the nature 2 to the power X. And you select B as some number 2 to the power y. Okay. Now, this is as good as saying x log 2 to, let's say, any base you want to put it, divided by y log 2 to any base you want to put it. Anyways, they're going to get canceled off. I'm just put E for the sake of putting a base. So here you want this guy to be an integer, isn't it? So if log A to the base B is an integer. Okay, so we'll say let A is 2 to the power X, let B be 2 to the power Y, because A and B are chosen from these powers of 2. So this implies that if this is to be an integer, that means your X and Y, that means your number 1, 2, 3, 4, 25 should be chosen in such a way that X is divisible by Y completely. Okay, so how many options you have for that? Okay, so let's figure it out. If you choose y as let's say 1, how many possibilities you have for x? How many possibilities you have for x? So let's say you choose 2 as your b. Okay, that means you have chosen y as 1, right? Then how many possibilities you have for the power? You can choose any number from 2 to 25. Correct. So your X can be 2, 3, 4 till 25. Isn't it? In short, your B could be, if your B is 2 to the power 1, then your A could be any number from 2 to the power 2 all the way till 2 to the power 25. Right. In short, you have 24 such choices. Okay, so 24 choices or 24 ways. In a similar way, if I choose y as 2, how many choices of x you will have? Can I say they will be all multiples of 2 other than 2 to the power 2, which is other than 2 itself? So this will be going all the way till 24, right? So how many such choices? I think this will be 11 such choices, isn't it? Yes or no? Correct? Anusha, why 23? 24 it should be enough for the first one. Anurag also. Yeah. Similarly, y is equal to 3. What are the choices of x that I will have? I will have 6, 9, 12, 15, till 24. So how many of them? It will be 18 by 3 plus 1, 7 choices or 7 ways to do this. Okay. Similarly, we can go, see, I can go add the max to 12. Okay, so y can go add the max to 12 because after 2 to the power 12, you will not be able to get a such a y for which any 2 to the power x will be divisible. Okay, so we'll go till 12. So basically we'll have 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Don't worry, the count will be not very great towards the end. 11 and 12. Okay. So this is going to be multiples of 4. So this is going to give you 8, 12, 16, 20, 24. In fact, literally we can count it. This is going to be 5. Okay. So for 5, you can have 10, 15, 20, 25. So that will be 4. Okay. For 6, you will have 12, 18, 24. That's only 3. For 7, you will have 14, 21. That's only 2. For 8, you will have 16, 24. That's only 1. And I think beyond 9 and all, you will only get 1, 1, 1. Because only 18 will be there, only 20 will be there, only 22 will be there, only 24 will be there. So these all counts will be 1, 1, 1. Let me maintain the color code here, 1, 1, 1. Okay, so altogether, I think I've written an extra one. Yeah. This is 2. This is 1. Yeah. So altogether, let's have a count of the total number. 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, and this will be 8, 11, 15, 20, 27, and 35, which is going to be 62. Okay. So 62 ways is your number of favorable events. This is going to be 62. Sample space, as we already counted, was 600. So the probability of this event will be 62 upon 600, which is nothing but 31 by 300. Yes, faster way to do this. You have to keep taking the GIF of these functions. I mean, anyways, you're doing the same thing actually, but literally you have to count it here. If you have a faster way to do it, please recommend it to me. Please recommend it to the class also. But I feel this is the way we can do it. It is not a lengthy way, by the way, Kinshuk. These all are considered to be, good enough a way to solve the question. It's not a lengthy way. It's not considered to be a lengthy way. Okay, let's take one more question. Yes, as Anurag, you're right. In order to write it as a symbol, you can write it like that. Why it will not be easy if the power went to 100 or 200? What? You can't count number of terms in an arithmetic progression fast, Kinshuk. Oh, you'll say the cases formed will be more, right? So that kind of question may not be framed. Yeah. Okay, so look at this question. This question says that there is a function from x to y, which is having the domain 0 to 9. Okay. And y is the codomain, which is 0 to 100. It's given that f5 is 5. Find the probability that the function fx, in fact, it should be capital X. Use a black color. Yeah. To B, where B is a subset of Y, is a bijective function. Okay. So you don't have to evaluate it. I think they have given in terms of some kind of summation. Yeah. Options are in terms of summations in the denominator, at least. Correct. So when you are using that floor function, what floor there is a summation process for the floor function. Kshitij, you have to literally evaluate it, no? He's asking if the number of cases were running up to 100, how would you do it? Of course, you are using floor function indirectly, but is there any formula by which you can sum up such floor functions also? No, right? You have to literally put your I values as per your question and try to find it. His question, Kinshuk's question is, if your numbers, let's say, if you had powers from 2 to the power 1 till 2 to the power 200, then how are you going to do it? Is there any shorter way to that? That is what was his question. Okay, so let's look into this. What you're not interested in? Oh, class 11th one. Okay, I'll send that to you. Don't worry. Sure, I'll do that. Kind of understanding, okay. See, it has nothing to, whatever we are doing, it has nothing to do with class 11 primarily. It's just that your permutation combination has to be good. The previous problem had nothing to do with class 11th. It was just your number of countings you're doing. But still, I'll send you, don't worry about it. Okay, so I'll be running the poll for this question as well. Some of you are giving me responses on the chat box. You can also click on the poll button. Very good. So 7 of you have already responded. Great. Number of bijective functions, how to find it out? We had already discussed this year itself in functions chapter. I have got almost 12 responses, but they are very, very scattered. Almost B, C, D have got equal votes. Now A has also come in. Okay, last 30 seconds. Since you don't have to perform any operation, it is just the options. If you see, they have kept it very raw form. They have just written, the unsolved format of that counting. So you don't have to count it out. Okay. All right. So let's begin the countdown. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Go. In case you want to take a guesswork, please do so. Just to see if you had taken a guesswork, would it come out to be correct or not? Don't shy away from taking a guesswork. Don't worry, I don't get to see who's taking what. Okay, Aditya, we'll check it out. All right, see, I'm stopping the poll. C is the most chosen response. Almost 41% of you say C. Of course, B and D are also quite close. Let's discuss this out. See, first of all, for a bijective function, see, you already know that 5 has to participate because they have already mentioned that F5 is 5. So this is a information which we cannot deny. So let us say 5 is definitely a part of your choices. Okay. Now, first of all, let us try to find out how many bijections I can create. In order to make a bijection, you should have the same number of element in X and B, right? Do you all agree with me? In order to have a bijection is what? Bijection is a 1-1 onto function. It's a 1-1 and onto function, right? In order to have 1-1 and onto function, number of element in X and number of element in B should be same. If anyone is less or more, it will not become a bijection. Are you getting my point? If let's say number of elements in B is less, then what will happen? In order to use the entire elements of X, you will have to do many to one mapping. So it will not be a 1-1 function. And if you have more number of elements in B, then what will happen? Some elements in B will be left unmapped because you have to do a 1-1 mapping only. So that will become into function. So into function is not onto. Right. So in order to meet this criteria of a bijection, you must have number of elements in X and B same, exactly same. Right. And now this fellow has already sacrosanct. It is already having 10 elements. Da, 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 da. In fact, in between, there is a 5 also. So I'll just write it down because this mapping is fixed. Okay. So in order to make a bijection function, I need to choose how many more elements for B? 9 more elements. From how many? Right. So see, 0 to 100, 101 elements are there, right? 5 is already used up. So 100 remain. From 100, I need to choose 9 more. Okay. So that I can choose in 100C 9 ways. Simple PNC doesn't require your, you know, class 12 topic knowledge also, correct? But when you have chosen that, how many, let's say you have now chosen 9 other elements. That means you have altogether 10 elements in B. Okay. So how many bijections can be formed if you have a function mapping to another function, both having 10 elements and one element is fixed? How many bijections will you have? But one is fixed, no, Hariharan. In this case, 5 is only mapping to 5. You can't change this, right? If there was a free hand, it would be 10 factorial, right? In this case, it will be 9 factorial because 5 is only mapping to 5. So you have to do the permutations of the other 9 elements of X with other 9 elements of B, correct? So everybody is fine with this. Now the problem is two of the options, C and D, say the same figure, right? So your answer has to be somewhere between C and D. So A and B is anyways ruled out mostly. Okay, we'll see. Now this is your favorable events, N, E. Correct? Now let's find out N, S, total number of sample space. Okay. So how many total functions can you make? So you can have a function made with as less a number as just a 5 in B, isn't it? Okay. So let's say if there is only 5 in B, how many functions can you make? One only, correct? So let's say your X is 0 till 9 and you only have a 5 here, only 5. How many functions you can make? Of course, I'm talking about functions. I'm not talking about bijection. Bijection, favorable cases I've already counted. So I'm counting how many total functions you can formulate. So how many such functions you can make where B is a subset of Y? This is what I'm counting. This is the count which I'm doing. Total number of such functions. Number of functions. Okay. So this is only one in number. Agreed? Okay. If I have two elements in your set B, 5 and one more, let's say one more, let me name it as maybe P. Okay. Then how many functions can you form here? Think an answer. Sarji, who will choose P? Okay. If there is two element, this is 2 to the power 9. Agreed. But who will choose P? You will not choose P. P has to be chosen. No, 100C1. It's 100C1, 2 to the power 9. Aita. Everybody's fine. Okay. So this also I can make 100C0. Okay. 1 to the power 9. Okay. I mean, just to make it as a 1. That's it. Anyways, let's say now I want to have 3 elements in B. 5 is already there. Pakka pakka. Okay. Ocha, one more thing I forgot. Five is already matching to 5, right? 5 will already map to 5. Correct? Oh, yeah, I've already accounted for it. Yeah. Every other elements have got two options each. So 0 has 2 options. 1 has 2 options. Only 5 has 1 option. So it'll be 2, 2, 2, 1, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2 like this. So only one of the twos, sorry, only one of the two will actually be a 1. Okay. Actually, I used the number of elements in codomain to the power of domain, but I was lucky to get it right because I counted it in my mind as a 9. But here the point is, see, 0 has got 2 options, either to map to P or to map to 5. 1 also has got 2 options, either to map to P or map to 5. Like that, all the elements other than 5 will have 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2 options. So 2 to the power 9, only 5 has 1 option to map to 5 only, because the question has already said F5 is 5. Okay. Yes. Similarly, can I say if I have 3 elements here, first of all, I have to choose those 2 elements. Now again, 0 will have 3 options. 1 will have 3 options. 2 will have 3 options. Only 5 has got 1 option, because it has to map to 5. So this will be 3 to the power 9. Now I think the trend is quite clear, isn't it? The trend is quite clear. So even if you go to the last counting, that means if you have, okay, what will be the last, let's say this thing, let's say if we have around, you know, all the 100 elements used here. Okay. Can I say it will be 100, each one of them will be having 101 options here other than 5. So it'll be 101 to the power of 9. Okay. Or you can say 101 to the power of 9. Correct. So in short, the total number of functions that you can form will be 100C1, or you can start with 1 also. 100C1, 2 to the power 9. 100C2, 3 to the power 9. All the way till 100C100, 101 to the power of 9. Can I not write this as summation R to the power 9? 100 CR minus 1, R starting from 1 to 101? Correct me if I'm wrong. So this is your sample space. Is this sitting in the denominator of any term? Option D. Okay. So option D. What is subjective case? Subjective case means the most broader case you're talking about. So favorable event is 100 C 9 into 9 factorial. Sample space will be summation R to the power 9, 100 C R minus 1, R equal to 1 till 101. For total events, it will be total events. F5 is 5 is true for sample space also. It is true for your favorable events also. This you cannot violate. There is a function which is satisfying F5 equal to 5 and it is operating from X to B. How many of them are bijective functions? So F5 equal to 5 is an universally applicable condition. Whether you apply it for favorable, you anyways have to apply. You also have to apply it for the sample space. I think many of you didn't account for that. You thought that F5 equal to 5 is only for favorable case. No, favorable case, if it was, then in the last part of the function, they would have written how many of them are bijective and F5 equal to 5. No, that is a misinterpretation of from your side. Question is very much clear about that this thing. Okay, we'll take one problem on your addition theorem also, because I think most of you would have forgotten that as well. So just a simple topic we'll take up. If A and B are two events such that PA intersection B is 0.3 and PA complement intersection B complement is 0.6, find the value of PA intersection B complement or A complement intersection B. Done, easy question. Excellent. Somebody has responded. Good time. 40 seconds is what he took. Good. So after this problem, we are going to resume with our class 12th probability. So those who were not there with us last year, don't worry. We will be starting this thing from the basics of class 12. So please pay attention. But having said that, being in centum or not in centum, you should be aware of the concept, right? You can't give a reason to the JEE main exam, sir, I joined centum, you know, much late, so I don't know these concepts. You have to remember it. You have to know the concepts. Done. I'll close this in the next 20 seconds. See, let's say this is your A and this is your B. Okay. I think all of you are already aware that this zone is called A intersection B complement. Okay. And this zone is called B intersection A complement, or you can say A complement intersection B. Okay. Just use this fact and see whether you are able to solve this. Okay. Should I close the poll now? 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay, end of poll. Most of you have gone with option number D. Okay. Let's discuss this out. See, as you can see from the diagram, if somebody is asking you what is the union of this, okay, now let's recall our very first formula of addition theorem. We know that probability of the occurrence of a compound event, okay, P or Y, is basically PX plus PY minus P intersection Y. Very simple, very similar to the cardinal property of sets that you would have studied in the very first chapter of your class 11th. But here, if you see, if you treat this as your X and if you treat this as your Y, okay, so it will be P A intersection B complement, P A intersection, A complement intersection B. Okay, why did I put extra brackets here? Not required. Okay. And what about their intersection? As you can see from the Venn diagram, these two events will never have anything in common. So can I say this last part here would be a zero? Okay. Now, in order to find this, can I also use this diagram and say it is actually PA union B minus PA intersection B? Because if you need this shaded area, it can also be written as, in fact, the shaded area itself could be combinedly written as A union B minus A intersection B, isn't it? So from the union, you remove the intersection part, that will leave you with A intersection B complement union A complement intersection B. Now, are these two informations given to us directly or indirectly in the question? Let us see it. Yes, I think PA intersection B is given to us as 0.3. PA union B we have to find out. That also we can find out by making use of De Morgan's law over here. So we know that PA complement intersection B complement is PA union B whole complement. Correct? So this is nothing but 1 minus PA union B. Correct? And PA union B, what am I writing? So PA union B, I have to make the subject of the formula. So that will be 1 minus PA complement intersection B complement, which is 1 minus 0.6, which is 0.4. So use this 0.4 here. So answer will be 0.4 minus 0.3, which is option number D clearly. And I think most of you had said D as well. Very good. Is this fine? Any questions, any concerns? Okay. Now these things we already done in our last year. Okay. So we'll not be spending too much time on this. So now we'll start with our independent events. Independent events. The very first topic of our class 12th. Normally in school, they don't start with independent event. Rather, they start with conditional probability directly, because in board exam, most of the questions will be around your conditional probability. But for JE and all, independent events questions are asked, you know, very, very commonly. So I would like to ask from you, when is a compound event? What is a compound event? Where there is a multiple events happening. Okay, so when is a compound event A intersection B an independent event. When will be this event called as a, when will this be an independent, sorry, when will your A and B be independent events? You can apply to multiple events also. So when will you say A and B are independent events? When intersection is a null set? No, that is exclusive events. Anusha, you need to be very careful about the uses of independent and exclusive. Exclusive event means their intersection is a null set. That doesn't make them independent, however. Okay. All right. A and B are independent events if occurrence or non-occurrence of one, occurrence slash non-occurrence of one, does not influence or does not affect the occurrence or non-occurrence of the other, occurrence or both non-occurrence of the other. Okay, and you can scale this definition to multiple number of independent events. So let's say A, B, C, D, are independent events. If occurrence or non-occurrence of one does not influence or affect the occurrence of or non-occurrence of any other event in that. Okay. Now, if two events are independent, we normally say that the probability of occurrence of their compound event A intersection B will be PA into PB. Not zero, unless until one of them is zero. Okay. So please note this down. This is very, very important. If A and B are independent events, the occurrence of both A and B is as good as both of them are occurring, you know, independent of each other. A simple example for the same would be, let's say you are, you have a coin and you have a die. You're tossing a coin and you're rolling a die. What is the probability of you getting heads on the coin and the number six on the die? What will you say? Does getting a head on the coin influence getting a six on the die? Will it be like, okay, now I'm head, you can't be six? Is there any kind of a hindrance given by the occurrence of a head? No, right? So they're independent. So you'll say, sir, it is as good as you getting a head on the coin and as good as you getting a six on the die, which is half into 1/6, 1/12, correct? Isn't it? Or if you would have done these, you know, questions in class 11th, where you are drawing two balls from a bag with replacement. So with replacement, questions become independent events. Okay, so another example I can cite here is, let us say there is a bag which contains three distinct red balls. Three distinct red balls mean they're all red, but let's say they are all, you know, different from each other in terms of hue. Maybe some is a faded red, some is blood red, something like that. And let's say there are four blue balls. Let's say you're drawing two balls out of the bag, okay? But with replacement. With replacement means you're drawing a bag and then you're putting it back again, okay? So my question is, what is the probability of you getting first a red, okay? And second, a blue ball, okay? So what will you say? So first red is 3/7. Now you're putting it back. Then you're drawing another ball. So what is the chance of it being blue? So that is again 4/7. Simple as that. So 12/49. So it's as good as you drawing a red ball from the bag and as good as drawing a blue ball, or, you know, drawing a blue ball probability and multiplying both the results. So occurrence of a red in the first draw will not affect the occurrence of the blue in the second draw because the red has been replaced back in the bag. So these two events will be independent. Are you getting my point? Now, please keep this as your guiding principle for knowing whether two events are independent or not, because a lot of questions will be asked, you know, in a very, you can say, difficult to understand language. Okay, they'll mix some, you know, language and they will say, okay, are these two events independent? If you are able to figure that the two events are such that the compound occurrence of A and B, that means the probability of occurrence of A and B is the product of the probability of occurrence of A into B, then only you claim that, then only you claim that A and B are independent. Okay, we'll take some questions, don't worry, based on that. But don't judge the question just by looking at it. No, I feel A and B are independent. No, they don't run by your whims and fancies. If you feel and you're correct, then nothing like that. I mean, that means you have skills, you're blessed with the art of finding the, dependent, independent nature without solving the question. But rely on this operation to basically know whether A and B are independent or not. Okay. Is this fine? Are these two examples good enough? So now let us look into some properties of dependent and independent. Properties of independent event. Okay, let me ask this as a question rather than giving you a property. Okay, so let's say there is a event A and there is a null event. Are these two independent? Yes, in that case, it will become a conditional probability. We'll talk about that, Kinshuk. Is event A and a null set independent events? The answer to this is yes. They will be considered to be independent events. Okay. For the simple reason, they satisfy PA intersection a null set, which is actually what? Actually zero only, right? And this also is a zero. So this will be also a zero. This will also be zero because this is going to be a null set only. Okay. And zero will be equal to zero. That condition is satisfied. And that's why they are independent. Okay. What about A and the sample space? Is A and the sample space independent or dependent? Let me ask you like this. Are they independent or not? Independent? So what is PA intersection S? It is as good as PA. Okay. And what is PA into PS? You'll say it is PA into one because sample space occurrence is one. Are they both the same? Isn't it? So this implies PA intersection S is PA into PS. The moment this criteria is solved, that means PA intersection B is PA into PB. Immediately you can say, yes, they are independent. Okay. Not a very useful property, but you should be knowing it because you can be asked in a multiple option correct. Which of the following options are correct? Okay. Now, if A and B are independent events, if A and B are independent events, then what can you claim about A and B complement? Will they be independent or will they not? I mean, will they be independent or you can't say? No, I don't think so. They will. Can't say means it may be independent, may not be. Okay. Depending upon the cases. If A and B are independent, will A and A complement be independent? Okay, Shambho. Doesn't necessarily have to be, okay? Okay, Shitij is saying it has to be. Pranav is also saying it has to be. Many of you are saying it has to be, but some of you are saying need not be. Okay, let's discuss. So as of now, the verdict, I don't know. Okay, what is this? I don't know. I'll just put a question mark. But I'll just try and check my understanding of the fact that does this give you PA into PB complement? That's the test that you should always perform if you're not sure whether two events will be independent or not. Don't take a call based on your, gut feeling that I feel they're going to be independent, or I feel that they're going to be dependent. There's nothing we can say about. Just take a call basis of what comes out as a result of this operation. Does it give you PA into PB complement? If yes, my answer to this is yes, they're independent. If it gives something else, no, we can't claim that it is always independent. Okay, let's check it out. So PA into PB complement. Okay, so we all know that from our diagram that this is the area which shows, this is the area which shows PA intersection B complement. So can I say it is as good as saying PA minus PA intersection B? Yes or no? Correct? Now, since A and B are independent, can we not claim that PA intersection B is PA into PB? We can claim, right? If they are independent, this condition will be true. Correct. So in light of this, I'm just rewriting the expression back. In light of this, can I say this term I can write it as PA into PB? Because A and B are independent. Take PA common, it will be 1 minus PB. Correct? And what is 1 minus PB? PB complement. Correct? So this I can write it as PA into PB complement. So what did I figure out, my dear? Those who are saying, not sure, we figured out here that the moral of the story is that this was giving you PA into PB complement. That means the verdict here, the question mark here now is resolved. They have to be independent. So even these two events are independent events. Is it clear? Any questions, any concerns? Good enough. Okay. Let's say I call this as 3A. Let's move on to 3B. Do I have to explain anything over here, or everything is clear from this operation? Again, I'm using my addition theorems to come up to these results. So class 11 becomes a pivot point for me, or you can say it becomes a prerequisite for me to get to these results. These are all addition theorems, whatever I'm using. Okay. All right. We'll move on to third B property now. Third B, again, I'll list it down without proving it because it is very obvious. Similarly, A complement and B, they will also be independent. So if A and B are independent, then even A complement and B will be independent events. Same logic. It's just that name is changed from AB to BA, nothing else. Okay. Now the C part, I would like you to again prove this. Do you think their complements, are they independent? What do you think? Yes, no, can't say. If A, B are independent events, if A and B are independent events, is A complement, B complement independent, or nothing can be said? Not independent. Okay, Sharan. Anybody who thinks otherwise? Okay, Vaibhav has a different opinion. Okay, Vaibhav, good. So there are two Vaibhavs in this session. Vaibhav M and Vaibhav S, right? I think Vaibhav M has kept M in the name. And I think there are two Siddhants also, isn't it? Siddhant, okay. Okay, okay, good, good, good. Two Anushas also. Two Gayatris also would be there. No, one of the Gayatris is absent. They are not. Okay, so both the answers are coming. Okay, let's start from basics. Okay, let's not take a judgmental call here. Let's take a logical call. See, all I need to show to the examiner or show to myself, more importantly, that if this is equal to PA into PB, then only I will claim it to be independent, else not. Simple as that. Now, we all know that by De Morgan's law, this is nothing but PA union B whole complement. That's nothing but 1 minus PA union B. Correct. Now, what is PA union B? PA union B is PA, PB minus PA intersection B. Correct. Which is 1 minus PA minus PB plus PA intersection B. Okay. Now, you know A and B are independent. If A and B are independent, this guy could be written as PA into PB. Okay. Now, we know that since A and B are independent, PA intersection B is PA into PB. Right. So, this becomes 1 minus PA minus PB plus PA PB. Okay. So take PB minus PB common from the second last two terms. You'll get 1 minus PA. Okay. So basically factorize it. So you have two factors, 1 minus PA coming and 1 minus PB coming. 1 minus PA is PA complement. 1 minus PB is PB complement. That's what I wanted, no, right? In fact, I wanted to verify that whether this is coming or not. So what did we conclude? That if this is coming out from two such events, okay, what does it mean? It means that these two are independent events. These two complementary events, these A complement and B complement are independent events. Why am I writing complementary? Sorry about that. Independent events. Okay. So what is the moral of the story? If A and B are independent, it makes A, B complement, both events independent, A complement and B also independent, and A complement, B complement, both also independent. Okay. So these questions have been directly asked in several competitive exams. Yeah, sure, Akash. If you want to copy anything down, please do so. Do you remember this property? I will never say to remember anything. This is actually, I mean, sometimes we are hardwired to think also in this nature. Okay. But many times when we don't, I would always suggest you use your basic addition principles, use your basic definitions and get it done. If you know it, if you remember it, you save time. But if not, if let's say there was a question where it had figures instead of A and B, it had situations instead of A and B, and the question you asked me whether these two events are independent, then I would not, you know, think of this formula first. Maybe I will, you know, go from my basics. So I will try to see whether PA into PB, whatever are the events, whether it is written in terms of complement or not complement, is it PA into PB? If it is satisfied, then yes, they are independent. But learning, if you are able to see such, you know, exact expressions in the options, then probably remembering the formula would have helped you. Okay. Else you have to solve it as if you have been given some neutral question. Okay. Now, based on this, there is one more property. In fact, it's actually an extension of property number three, last part. This is called the complementation law or complementation rule. Complementation rule. Why my handwriting is not that good today? Yeah. So complementation rule says that if A and B are independent events, are independent events, then PA union B will be 1 minus PA complement into PB complement. Okay. Now the proof for this is same as what we did just now. The proof is same as what we did just now. We basically did the fact that if A and B are independent events, so would be their complements, right? That means we learned this from our previous property. Okay. So from this is from our previous property. Previous property. Correct. And what is this? This is PA union B whole complement. So this is just a new version, you can say, another way of looking at it. So 1 minus PA union B is PA complement into PB complement. So basically you get the proof as PA union B as 1 minus this. Okay. Now, do you recall those questions where you used to have this in class 11 that let's say A and B both are trying to solve a problem? Okay, the chances of A solving a problem is, let's say, you know, something. Chances of B solving a problem is something. What is the chance that the problem will be solved? So what do you used to do? You used to say, okay, let the problem be not solved by both of them. 1 minus that will be the problem getting solved by at least one of them. So this is the same thing actually written in a, you can say, mathematical, you know, jargons. Okay, that is why I say, some people are hardwired to solve this question even without knowing these properties. So indirectly, they will be using this property without knowing that they were using this property just because they could frame the question through logic. So logic is above everything. All these formulas, properties are, you know, evolving from that logic. So never say, you know, keep aside your logic and work with formula. Formula is going to ditch you long time, okay, big time. Are we assuming A and B are exhaustive? No, that was never said here. A and B are independent events. Exhaustive events work when they are events coming from the same, you can say, bigger event. Right. So it may be like tossing a coin and rolling a die. So how do you talk about exhaustive event there? Hariya. No, it's always true. Ayo. Whether A is exhaustive or not exhaustive, this thing will always be true, no? Oh, sorry. I wrote a compliment on top there. Yeah. This is always true, no? See, independent and exhaustive. See, I mean, you have to define an event like this. Exhaustive means they together will make the sample space of that entire experiment that you are performing. So let's say you are tossing a coin. Head, tail, they are exhaustive events. Correct? Are you getting my point? And they are exclusive events. You can't use the word mutually, you can't use the word independent there, because they can't occur together when the experiment is performed. Are you getting my point, Aditya? So your question is, can there be events which are independent and exhaustive? So independent events, I mean, ask yourself, independent events, do they come from the same experiment? This is tossing a coin. Right? If I toss a coin or if I roll a die, can you tell me two events here which are independent of each other? But can you tell me two events which are exclusive and exhaustive? Exclusive, I think getting a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, they're all exhaustive events, because if you together add them, they will give you a 1. Try to understand the definition of all these things. I think I need to go back to class 11th. When you say exhaustive, E1, E2, E3, let's say these are the events associated with an experiment. They are exhaustive when they add up to give you a 1. Okay. Now, many people think PE1 plus PE2, etc., they will give you 1. That is only when they are exhaustive and mutually exclusive. That happens in case of complementary events. Don't get confused here. So I'll just give a simple example. Let's forget about E1, E2 till EN. If E1 and E2 are exhaustive, they will satisfy this condition. Correct? If E1 and E2 are exclusive, then they will satisfy this condition. Right? So basically, this is equivalent to saying E1 union E2 is your sample space. Right? But that doesn't mean they are exclusive of each other. Correct? Here, E1 and E2 are exhaustive if they are disjoint. Correct. E1 and E2 are complementary. Let me write it down here. E1 and E2 are complementary. Complementary. If they are both, actually, that means E1 union E2 is your sample space and E1 intersection E2 is a null space. If both these criteria are satisfied, then they are complementary. Now, if they are complementary and they're satisfying this, so first of all, you can say that this is equal to 1 and you can say that this is equal to 0. Now, using this fact, you can say PE1 plus PE2 minus PE intersection, E1 intersection E2 is equal to 1. And because of this, this fellow becomes a 0. And because of this, you end up getting something like this. And because of this, there is a property that if E1 and E2 are complementary, the probability of one will be 1 minus the probability of the other. That means if I write x here, this will be 1 minus px complement. Correct? So if an event x, you're talking about with its complementary, no matter whatever is the event, this condition will always be satisfied. Understood. I think there is a lot of doubt related to exhaustive, exclusive, complementary, and now you're learning independent also. So independent means that PA intersection B is PA into PB. And A and B need not come from the same experiment. Getting a point? So they will not come from the same experiment. Like tossing a coin, rolling a die, independent. You being tall and you being good in studies, independent events. Right? Height doesn't reduce your brain power. Many people say shorter people are intelligent. So all the girls must be intelligent. There's no correlation like that. Okay, is this fine? Any questions? Now, this property can be extended. That means you can generalize this property. And you can say that if you have E1, E2, E3, etc., some set of events which are all independent of each other, are independent events, then their union would be 1 minus the product of their complement probability. Okay, so you just have to remember this property and you just have scaled it up to this. Okay, so in general this property is going to hold true. Okay, this is called the complementation law. And again, I am telling you guys and girls, this is only when the question gives you sets kind of a thing in the question. If they give you some kind of a situation, this can automatically be obtained from logic. You don't have to remember it. So I'm giving you all these properties because sometimes they will say, okay, A, B are independent events. Which of the following options are correct? A and B complement are independent. A complement B are independent. A complement B complement are independent. PA union B is 1 minus PA complement B. So in that situation, if you remember this property, you are through. You can save a lot of time. But normally they give questions where there is a wording, there is a situation involved. And in that case, these formulas will automatically be obtained from the logical part. You don't have to remember it. If you remember it, good. Not also, it will not hit you. Let's take questions. I think we have discussed our independent events to a considerable depth. So let's discuss them out. Again, I would like to ask anybody, is there any confusion related to exhaustive events? If you want to give me examples, I can give you. For example, exhaustive events are, let's say, I take a situation. Let's say you're rolling a die. So E1 is you getting 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. E2, you are rolling a die and you're getting, let's say, 3, 4, 5, 6. Are these two events exhaustive when you're rolling a die? You'll say, yes, sir. Because if you take the union of both of them, you get a sample space. So they are exhaustive. Correct? So in this case, P, E1 union E2 will be a 1. Okay. But are they mutually exclusive? No, because they have 3 and 4 common. So let's say I give you a mutually exclusive events. So rolling a die, mutually exclusive events like you getting an odd number and you getting an even number. But right now I have taken a case where they are mutually exclusive, but yet exhaustive, right? But you could have a case like this also. Let's say I don't put a 6. So this is mutually exclusive events. They do not have anything in common. So this is mutually exclusive, but not exhaustive. Mind you, because 6 is not there. If I put a 6 there, then exhaustive and mutually exclusive. Okay. So here their intersection is a null set. Simple as that. What is complementary event? Now again, these two are complementary also because let's say if I put a 6, let's say 1, 3, 5 and 2, 4, 6. Then these are complementary events because together they make the sample space and mutually exclusive, nothing in common. Correct? So that is why you say the probability of you getting an odd number is 1 minus you probability of getting an even number. Get this distinction clear. Right? But if I say, are they independent events? So you'll say, let's check. Are these two independent events? Let's check. So what is the probability of E1 intersection E2? E1 intersection E2 have only 2 events, correct? So their probability will be 2 by 6, which is 1 by 3. Is it equal to PE1 into PE2? Let's see, figure it out. PE1 is what? Probability of you getting 1, 2, 3, 4 is 4 by 6. Probability of getting 3, 4, 5, 6 is again 4 by 6. Multiplication will give you something like 4 by 9, not equal. So they cannot be called as an independent events. Got the point? Is the idea clear now, everybody? Okay. Please do not be in any confusion, okay? Because later on, you'll be going to hit very hard when typical problem comes on this. Sorry. You have not done conditional probability. So bad question to pick up. Sorry about that. think I've taken some. Ah, let's take this one. Now, I'm not pu putting any poll for this because I'm not very sure whether multiple options may be correct or not. If you think multiple options are correct, please give me all the choices that you think are correct. Is there any person sitting here who can actually read this and say, sir, this is option is correct without picking up the pen? It's difficult actually, right? I mean, knowing two events are independent by just reading the question. See, many times it is obvious. I don't deny that. But most of the time I feel reading the question will not say, ah, this seems to be independent. Huh? Anybody who basically has that power of guessing like that. Pranav wants to try. Okay, Pranav, go ahead. Very good, Kinshuk. Excellent. Okay, Anirudh. Okay, Raghav. That depends on the person also, Kinshuk. Okay, so Anusha, you think they are pairwise independent also, and all of them together also are independent. Okay. Okay, Ruchita, Ritu, Gayatri, Rohan, Pranav. Okay, should we discuss it, guys? Anybody else? Anybody? Gaurav? Gurman? Gurman has been quiet for a long time. Where is this guy, Oshik? Oshik Dhar, is he all right? Why doesn't he come for class? Oshik from Kormangla. Yeah, yeah. Ask him to keep sleeping. He'll wake up in a very with a very bad dream. Then he has not been coming to class, and same goes with Arabi. Arabi and. Yeah, I've been observing few of you are not coming for the regular classes. There is a guy called Raghuram. Raghuram in YPR. He also same thing. Okay, let's discuss it. See, your kismet is in your hands, right? No teacher, no coaching institute can change it. Not even your parents can change it. You can only change it. See, first of all, E1 is what? E1 is the event where the ticket that you have drawn has the first digit as 2. Okay. So can I say that favorable event will be 2 if you pick 211 or 222? Correct. So favorable will be 2. Total number of tickets is 4. Correct. So probability of even will be half. Agreed, everybody? Probability of E2. Arre bhai, neat he is considering. Board he will write? No. So am I not teaching board stuff? This is all board stuff. Yeah. So E2 will be what? Probability of you getting the second digit on the ticket that you have drawn as a 2. So there are two such cases again, 121 and 222. So that will again be 1/2. Now probability of E3 is the third ticket being 2, that is this, and this again. So again, 1/2, no doubt. Okay. Now, what is the probability of E1 and E2? That means the first and the second digits both are 22. That can only happen in the last case. First and second both are 22. So 1/4. Is it equal to PE1 into PE2? Yes, it is, because both are half each. So E1 and E2 are independent is absolutely correct. So option number A will be right. Now E2 and E3, so the second digit and third digit both should be 2. The probability is again 1/4, because only in the last case it is happening. And this is also equal to half into half, which is this. So E2 and E3 are also independent. That means option number B will be correct. And I'm sure E3 and E1 will also be independent, because third digit and first digit being 2 is also happening in only one case out of 4, which is actually half into half again. Okay. So this is also independent. So A, B, C is pakka correct. But are all of them correct? That means all the three are independent. So let's check. So E1 intersection, E2 intersection, E3, that means all of them being 222 is only 1/4. That's the last number, but this doesn't match with half into half into half. That means it doesn't match with this. So claiming the last option to be correct will lead to a negative mark. So only option A, B, C are right options. These are the only right options. Any questions here? Any questions, any concerns? Next question. Okay, I'll give you a question for my side. Question is, they are mutually independent, but not taken together. How come two events be mutually exclusive, but three may not be? Are you getting my point? See, let's take a question here. Again, this is a question which is based on your word problem. So there is a family which has got 3 children. A family has 3 children. Okay. Event A is that a family has at most 1 boy. Event A is that the family has at most 1 boy. Has at most 1 boy. B is the event that family has at least one boy and girl. At least one boy and one girl. Okay. And event C is family has at most one girl. Okay. Which of the following options are correct? A and B are independent. A and B are not independent. A, B, C are independent. A, B, C are not independent. Simple options. Okay, Pranav, Anurag, Archit. Good. Quick to answer. Okay, Raghav. Raghav, you are consistently giving incorrect answers. Last also you got it wrong. You said D only. But D was the only option which was not correct. Of course, here also you're wrong. IMO and all, probability is the main key ingredient of these IMO and whatever camp you're trying to be. Okay, Kshitij. See, first of all, I would like to, irrespective whether you have solved it or not. Okay, let's try to answer the following questions. Okay. What is the probability of A to happen? Just tell me, what is the probability of A? The family has at most one boy. Right. So how do you find it? See, now the family has got three children, right? Child one, child two, child three. Okay. You want at most one boy means either the family doesn't have a boy, correct? Or the family has exactly one boy. Am I right? Okay. So can I say this is as good as finding no boy or exactly one boy? Is what you are finding. So what is the probability of no boy? See, by the way, these two events are mutually exclusive. Okay, so you can directly write it like this. So you can break this event as probability of no boy and probability of exactly one boy. Okay, what is the probability of no boy? 1/8. Correct? So out of total cases, see, each of them can have two genders, right? Male, female, male, female, male, female. Out of that, all of them have to be female, female, female. So one such case out of 8. Or you can say 1/2 to the power of 3. That is also a good way to talk about it. Okay. Right? By actually, you are using the fact that child 1, child 2, child 3, their sexes will be independent of each other, isn't it? So 1/2 chance of being a boy, 1/2 chance of being a girl. So 1/2 into 1/2 into 1/2. The probability of exactly one boy. Now you have to choose which one you want to keep as a boy. Out of the 3 children, which one you want to be a boy, that itself can be chosen in 3C one way. And then again, 1/2 to the power of 3. Correct? So yes, I'm so sorry. This is power of 3, not power of 2. Distinct. They're distinct. You having one boy and that boy is the first child is different from you having one boy and the boy is the second child and you having one boy and the boy is the third child. That's distinct, Aditya. Why not? You're dealing with distinct objects, human beings, children. Okay. So answer is 1/8 + 3/8. Answer is 4/8, which is 1/2. Let's see. I mean, does it matter in the question that is independent? Right. Now, what is PC? Same will be PC also, because you getting one, at most one girl is equivalent to saying you getting one boy, because the situation is same, that to one girl now. Okay. Now, what about the B case? At least one boy and one girl. So one boy and one girl is saying you have one boy plus two girl scenario, or you have one girl plus two boy scenario. Okay, so again, we can say they are mutually exclusive. So you can just say this is as good as this plus this. Okay, so what is the probability that in the family, there is one boy and two girls? Now, here also, very important. You have to first decide which two children will be girls. Of course, it's all in the hand of gods. So 3C2 way of deciding which children will be girls. Okay. And then it'll be 1/2 into 1/2 into 1/2. So you can say 1/2 cube again. Oh, so sorry. 1/2 cube. Correct. Same goes with this also. 3C2 into 1/2 into 1/2 into 1/2. So here in this case, it will be 3/8 into 2. That's 3/4. Is it fine? Okay. Now, having known PA, PB, PC, let's try to address the question. The question says A and B are independent. Now, what is A and B? A and B means you want at most one boy, but at the same time, you want at least one boy. That means it has to be a one boy, two girl case. Am I right? This has to be one boy. Why am I writing one in? Okay, one boy and two girls case. Correct? So what is that to happen? I think we have already figured it out over here. That is going to be 3/4. So is it PA into PB equal to 3/4? Let's try to figure it out. Does it equal to 3/4? Let's try to figure it out. PA was 1/2. PB was 3/4. Sorry, this was 3/8, I believe. Sorry. Yeah, I forgot. I'm just dealing with 1/2 the expression, not the full. So yeah, it is equal. Okay, so what does it mean? It means PA intersection B is PA into PB. So they are independent. Option number A is right. Got it? So B cannot be right. Right? Let's check C now. Are A, B, C independent? So A, B, C means what? you want at most one boy, you want at least one boy, one girl, and you want at most one girl. So which is this situation? Can it happen actually? Can all the three be simultaneously be satisfied that you are having at most one boy, okay, at most one girl, correct? And at least one boy and one girl. So let's say one boy and one girl, A and C, are already satisfied. And you have to have three children, right? So the third one will be a boy or will be a girl. If it is a boy, it will violate A. If it is a girl, it will violate C. So together, they cannot happen. It's my coin word, together. Together, they cannot happen, right? And this doesn't match with PA into PB into PC, which is equal to half into 3/4 into half. So they are not independent. They are not independent. So option number A and D are correct in this. There are some people who solve this question pretty fast. Pranav is one of them. Pranav, how did you solve it so fast? Any trick you have? You can share. I mean, even if I don't write all the steps, or you use one of the previous methods. Okay, is it fine? I think we have done enough with our independent. Now let's move on to conditional probability, because that's where your major crux of the question or major part of the question are going to come. Okay, so I'm getting a lot of chats here. Raghav is asking so many questions. Raghav, can you just unmute and talk, because you have written so many things and I have to scroll up and read all the stuff. If you have any questions still, you can unmute and talk. Oh, you did a mistake. You realize it. Okay, no worries. It's fine. Okay, so before I move on, any questions related to independent events? So you'll be able to figure out whether two or more events are independent or not. So just follow whatever properties and things we are doing. And as you can see in these questions, reading them, that people read, A, is this B and this? Oh yeah, they're independent. That may not be possible every time, unless until you are trained to think like that, which I don't know how will it happen. Maybe Kinshuk has some idea. But if I were to do this one, I will literally find PA, PB, PA intersection B and check whether PA intersection B is PA into PB or not. Okay, so moving on to conditional probability. Conditional probability. Okay. See, conditional probability, the name itself says there is some condition which has occurred. Okay, so whatever probability you are trying to find out, you have been told some condition, okay, under which you have to evaluate it. Let me give you a funny story. Let's say there are two contestants for 100 meters. So let's say one of the contestant is, okay, Charan. Another contestant is, let's say, Mr. X. Okay. So Mr. X and Charan are, both of them are running for 100 meters together. What is the probability of Charan winning the 100 meters? What will you say? What is the chance of Charan winning that 100 meters? On a serious note, guys, please. Half, correct? But what if I say Charan is running with Mr. X, whose name is Usain Bolt? So he's running with Usain Bolt. What is the chance of Charan winning it? You'll say zero, sir. This guy will, okay? So here, the answer changed because you knew a condition, right? You knew something. I mean, not exactly the same as what I've given an example. This is just a funny example for you to get connected with the topic. So if you know something about the event or something that occurred before the event, then the probability of that will depend on what occurred. It will depend upon that condition that occurred. For example, let us say, again, I'll give you a realistic example. Let's say there are three red balls of different types in a bag, and let's say four blue balls of different types in the same bag. Okay. You are drawing two balls one after the other without replacement. Okay. Correct. My question to you is, what is the probability that the second ball is a blue ball? What is the probability that the second ball is a blue ball? Now here, if you see, which he normally does, I think in one of the races, he pulls a muscle and he abruptly stops. Yes. So now, because the question says there is a without replacement scenario, second ball being a blue depends on what has been drawn as the first ball. Because if you had drawn a red ball before, then your answer will be different. If you had drawn a blue ball before that second ball, then answer will be different, isn't it? It is not a with replacement that your answer doesn't depend upon what was drawn in the beginning. Had you put the ball one back again in the bag, then the probability of you drawing the second ball blue would have been as good as a 4/7. But now actually it depends on what you had drawn in the first go. Correct. So the probability of you drawing a blue ball basically will depend whether the previous ball was a blue or the previous ball was a red. Okay, now I have written some symbols on your screen right now. PB by B, PB by R, etc., etc. Okay, so what is this? Let me explain you all those things. So probability of A by B. Now it is written as A by B, but it is to be read as like this. So when you are reading it, you will read it like this. Probability of occurrence of A given B has occurred. Okay. And this result will be different if your information about, if they're independent. I mean, if they're dependent, answer will be different. If they're independent, answer will be different. If A and B are independent, then this value of P, A given B has occurred, is as good as A. Like the one that will happen when the balls were replaced back. Okay, the first ball was replaced back, right? But if the first ball is not replaced back, let's say the first ball was a blue, then your answer will not be the same as what you would have got when you had taken these two events as independently. Right? Right, Raghav. So we'll talk about all those things. Okay. So please note that when you say PA divided by B, you read it as probability of occurrence of A given B has occurred. And this is not equal to PA unless until A and B are independent events. Okay. And of course, in this case, your PB should not be zero. Okay. Because if B hasn't occurred at all, then the statement doesn't make any sense, that probability of occurrence of B given B has occurred. Okay. So B is an impossible event. That is you're trying to say. So B has to be some possible event. Then only you can talk about probability of occurrence of A given B has occurred. Okay. So now my next question is, okay, sir, this symbol is fine. We have understood what does this symbol say. How do you write down the formula for this? So in order to write down the formula for this, we read this conditional probability in light of multiplication theorem, which is very easy theorem. Again, see, all these names have been put in order that you refer to it while you're writing your answer. Most of these things are intuitive, but in the exam, you cannot say, intuitively thinking this is the answer, right? You have to support. Mathematics is a very, very logical subject. It's not like humanity. You have to give reason answer for everything that you're writing. So in order to say something, write something in the examination hall, of course, I'm talking about your board point of view.
because your second semester may be subjective one. You have to use these mathematical jargons because that increases your chances of getting higher percentage. Okay, so multiplication theorem says that if A and B events occur, okay, it can occur like this. PA occurs and then B occurs given A has occurred. Okay, or you could also write it like this. PB occurs into P A occurs given B has occurred. By the way, here please note that PA is not equal to zero here, and in this case PB is not equal to zero. Then only, okay, this will make sense, right? So this is conditional probability. So I was asking you a question that what is the probability of you getting? So let's say again I'll quote the same question: three red distinct balls, distinct blue balls. You're drawing two balls without replacement. Okay, what is the probability of you getting one red ball and one blue ball? Okay, so when red ball, if you want, you can take this event in two ways. Either the first ball is a red, whose probability is 3/7, and given the first ball is a red, the probability of you getting a blue ball will be 4/6. Are you getting my point? Clear? So this is what I'm calling as PA, and this is what I'm calling as P given, B has occurred. Okay. Or you can also say, if you want a red and a blue, at the end of the, this thing. Acha, when I say red and a blue, this could be red here and this is blue. Second ball is a blue. First ball is a red and second ball is a blue. Okay. Is it fine? Any questions? So this is saying red ball, first ball is a red, second ball is a blue. Now, can this multiplication theorem be extended to multiple events? Yes, we can generalize this. We can generalize it to saying that if you have A1, A2, A3, etc., okay, you can write it as PA1 into PA2 given A1 has occurred into PA3 given A1 and A2 has occurred into PA4 given A1, A2 and A3 has occurred, and so on and so forth, provided these guys are not null sets. Okay. They are not null sets. Okay. And so on. So using this multiplication theorem, you can always find out the expression for this. So I'm using this multiplication theorem part. And from here, I can say that your PA by B is given by PA intersection B by PB. Okay. Please note this formula down. This is the formula which you are going to use, n number of times in this chapter. Okay. So probability of occurrence of A given B has occurred is the probability of occurrence of both A and B divided by probability of occurrence of B. So in the previous part, we did the same thing, but PB there did not change. You're talking about when the replacement is done. No, in the previous part, PA by B became PA only because A and B were independent. It had nothing to do with whether the first ball was a red or not. So if the second ball is a blue, it had nothing to do with the first ball was a red or a blue. Okay. But here what is happening, you have a red ball as the first ball and blue ball as the second ball. So the probability of you getting blue ball as the second ball, given the first ball was a red, will now become 4/6 instead of 4/5. So that figure actually became higher because now you know that there is something occurred before this event, which increases the chances of you getting more blue balls or the chances of you getting a blue ball. Are you getting my point? Just like I gave that question, no? If one of the person is Usain Bolt, you know the chances of him winning is almost zero. So if you know there is a red ball drawn before it, the chances of you getting a blue in the second draw becomes 4/6 instead of 4/7. Higher chances. Okay. This is what is called the conditional probability. Any questions, any concerns here? I'll be taking word problems based on this, not to worry. But before that, I will take some properties of this formula or properties of conditional probability before I move on. Now here, many people ask me, sir, can we ever write this as PA/PB? So note, can you ever write this as PA/PB? If yes, under which situation will this happen? Tell me. Under which situation can you write this? Right, when A is a subset of B. So note, this will happen when A is a subset of B. Obviously, why? Because if A is a subset of B, A intersection B will be A, if A is a subset of B. Okay. So the numerator part, which is PA intersection B, that will become PA only. Right. So many times, this question is also framed like this, that can this be a possible answer for PA/B? The answer is yes, under the situation where A is a subset of B. Okay. Now, let us go to some properties of conditional probability. Properties of conditional probability. First property here is that probability of occurrence of this is actually PA itself. Okay. It is obvious. The proof is very simple. PA given S has occurred is PA intersection S by PS. PA intersection S is PA because A is a subset of S. PS is 1. That proves the okay, very trivial property, but you should be knowing it. But on the other hand, probability of occurrence of S given A has occurred is actually a 1. Again, the proof is very simple. Same way, PS given A has occurred is PS intersection A by PA. S intersection A is A. So PA by PA, that will actually be a 1. Okay. Next, probability of A complement given B has occurred is 1 minus probability of A given B has occurred. Now, please don't get confused here. Many people use this property incorrectly. They say probability of A complement by B complement is 1 minus. No, it's only A complement on top, no B complement. Okay. Can we prove this? In the interest of time, I'll be only doing it. So, P A complement given B has occurred is PA complement intersection B by PB. Okay. And what is PA complement given B? Now, remember again the Venn diagram. Venn diagram are very useful stuffs. Okay. Let's say this is A and this is B. This zone is your B intersection A complement, isn't it? This zone is your B intersection A complement or A complement intersection B. Doesn't matter. It's a commutative operation. So, can I say the numerator is PB minus PA intersection B? Okay. So if you individually divide, you'll be getting 1 minus PA intersection B by PB. And PA intersection B by PB is PA by B. Or P of occurrence or probability of occurrence of A given B has occurred. Isn't it? Okay. Now, obviously, a question will arise in your mind. So, sir, how can we write P A complement intersection B complement? See, for this, you have to again use your basic funda. Don't start, you know, guessing anything. Okay, please apply your basics. So basic says that this is going to be this. Okay, so basic says that this is going to be. Okay, I have not done that part, but still I will just write it down. Okay, this is again 1 minus PA union B by 1 minus PB. Again, this depends upon your expressions. Okay, so please do not get confused. This and this are not the same thing. So they are different things. Okay, next property that I would like to discuss here is, what is P A union B by C? First, copy this down. If you have any questions, anything that you would like to ask. Is it fine? All right. I think I can take here itself. PA union B given C has occurred is given by PA given C has occurred, PB given C has occurred minus PA intersection B given C has occurred. Okay. Now, as you can see here, my event on the numerator part over here is A union B. Okay. So how do we prove this? Simple. In this case, we will again rely on our basic definition of P A given B has occurred. So I can say this term is going to be P C intersection A union B upon PC, correct? As per our definition of conditional probability, PA union B given C has occurred is this, okay? Now you can write this by using your distributive law. So you know how to distribute intersection over union. So this will become C intersection A. Okay, union C intersection B. Am I right? Now, let's use our addition principle on this, treating this as X in our mind, treating this as Y in our mind. Can I write it as PX, PY minus P? Now, see, this intersection this. Okay. If you look at the last term, I'll just rewrite it again once. Okay. If you look at the last term, this is as good as probability of C intersection A intersection B. Am I right? Yes or no? So are you all happy with the writing of this last term like this? Any doubt related to it? Again, from your sets, topic. Now individually divide them by the denominator. Okay. This is as good as saying P A given C has occurred. This is as good as saying P B given C has occurred. Oh, I'm so sorry, B. Instead of P, I wrote a B. Yeah. And this is as good as A intersection B given C has occurred. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Anywhere you want me to scroll, please do let me know. Good enough? Please scroll up. Oh, sure, Siddhant. Scroll up means you want to see this part or you want to see the down part? See, it says that what is the probability of A or B to occur given C has occurred? So if you see the left side, Aditya, the way you pronounce it in the language of probability is, what is the probability that A or B occurs given C has occurred? So it is written as probability of occurrence of A given C has occurred, or probability of occurrence of B given C has occurred. And from there, you exclude the case or exclude those scenarios where both A and B has occurred, because there will be a double counting. Right. So this exclusion is because in the counting of those cases where A and B both have occurred when C has occurred, they will already be taken care once in probability of where A has occurred or the number of cases where A has occurred given C has occurred. So take your thinking process to your sets level. In set, what was there? Let's say this is the number of events where A occurred given C occurred. That means A and C both together occurred. This is the number of events where B occurred given C has occurred. And this is the number of events where both A and B occurred given C has occurred. So this is a double count in both of them. So you have to remove it once. Correct. Okay, now what type of questions will I get? So let's take the different varieties of questions that you can be asked. So first of all, I'll be taking up some questions where there is a. Okay, so we'll take. Let's take this question. I think this is a single option correct question. No, multiple option? Okay. question is saying which is not true, by the way. Not very sure. Okay. Okay, Rohan. Let's do one thing. Let's have a poll. If this is a single option correct, let's have a poll. So again, a reminder that tomorrow we'll be again continuing with the session. Okay, so Monday. to 11 a.m. you will have a maths class announcement. Math session, math class. No idea till when it is postponed. The matter is sub judice. It all depends upon how much time the court is taking. But court, given that it's a career related issue, the court will take it up on priority. The Honorable High Court is going to take it on priority. And we'll see. When do you think? I don't know, first week of. I think you were not attentive in the last class. I said I predict it to happen in the first week of January. I think with you people only, I was guessing. No? No? Okay. Fine. We'll stop the poll. I think 13 of you have responded. I'll give you 5 seconds to please give forth your response. Take a guess if you haven't solved it. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. When is the registration deadline for what, Siddhant? Has the J notification come? Has the JEE main registration come on their website, NATA website, NTA website? It hasn't come yet. So keep looking at the JEE main. So there is a window of 1 month to register. Okay, so once the notification comes that the exams are going to held on so-and-so date, they will give you everything. All the deadlines will be given there, Siddhant. Last day to fill, register yourself, last day to fill the registration fees, last day to do the correction in the form. So all those dates will be disclosed to you on the JEE main website, jeemain.ac.in, I think. Okay. We are also looking at it, but I think it will not come because they have recently concluded everything. So keep an eye on it. Keep an eye on it. Maybe every day once, just like you open your Instagram page or Facebook page, you can open your JEE main page also and have a look at it. Okay, nine people have said option B. Okay, let's check. See, first of all, we have been provided that PA is 1/4. PA by B is also 1/4. Now PA by B is what? PA intersection B by PA. Sorry, PB. Okay. This is also given to you as 1/4.
And you have been given that P B by A is 1/4. That means P A intersection B by P A, that is 1/2. So these are the three set of informations provided to us. Okay. Now A and B are independent. To know this, I need to know what is P A intersection B. So P A intersection B, I can get from the last information. So from here, I can say 1/2 into P A. P A is 1/4. So it is going to be 1/8. Okay, 1/8 is your P A intersection B. Now, if this is 1/8, PB can be known. So PB is 1/2. Okay. So is PA intersection B PA into PB? Yes, definitely it is true. That means they are independent. Okay. So option number one is wrong, because this is a correct statement. This is a true statement. Hence, it cannot be my option, because they're asking which is not true. Next, B. This is from the property itself, 1 minus PA by B. Okay. So 1 minus PA by B is 3/4. This is also a true statement, so cannot be a right option. Okay. Because this is also true. C says PB complement by A complement. So as we had already derived this, I think this was 1 minus PA union B by 1 minus PA. Correct me if I'm wrong. Correct me if I'm missing out anything. So what is PA union B? PA union B is PA plus PB minus PA intersection B. PA, I think, is already given 1/4. PB, we just now figured, was 1/2. And PA intersection B. Sorry, this got slightly. Yeah. PA intersection B, I think that also was figured out to be 1/8. So this will give you 2 + 4 - 1. How much is it? 5/8. Correct. And down in the denominator, you have 1 minus PA. 1 minus PA is 1 - 1/4, which is 3/4. Okay. So your answer is going to be 1 - 5/8 / 1/3/4. So this is, I think, 3/8 / 1/4. That's 1/2. So this is also correct. So this cannot be my answer, because this is a true statement. So the answer to this question is none of these. Let me check the poll. Only 4 people said none of these. Why? Any doubt, any questions here, anybody? Okay. No problem, Ariel. Should we take the next problem now? Okay. So I'll still take it on the properties that you have done. Let's take. I don't plan to start with the word problems now. I can take this fellow. Should I put the poll for this? Okay, very good. Two people have responded. Different answers coming up. Okay, Raghav. So let's hope this is correct. Last 1 minute, those who want to poll, please give your response on the poll in the last 40 seconds now. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, end of poll. I could see only 15 of you having responded in this, and most people say option C. Very few people say option A. Okay, so Raghav, who is saying A, very few people, Raghav, are concurring with you on that. Let's see whether they all are wrong and you are correct or vice versa. So first of all, PA is 0.7, undoubtedly. Okay, PB is already given 0.5. PA intersection B is given to you as 0.3. Okay, now, it is, I think the probability is high. let's see. So P, B given A union B complement has occurred is nothing but probability of B intersection A union B complement by P A union B complement, correct? As per the multiplication theorem, this is the definition of probability of a conditional event, conditional probability. So this is going to be, if I'm not mistaken, P B intersection A union P B intersection B complement. But this event is a null event, okay? So that is as good as taking union with some null thing. That is as good as PA intersection B only. So this is going to be your final expression, isn't it? A intersection B is 0.3, no doubt. What about the denominator? Denominator, I can say PA, PB complement minus PA intersection B complement. Correct. So PA is 0.7, PB complement is 0.5. Now, what is PA intersection B complement? All of you, please pay attention. This area is PA intersection B complement. So isn't this PA minus PA intersection B? Isn't it? Right. So I think when you open the brackets, PA, PA will get cancelled off and you'll have this plus 0.3. So answer is 3/8. Okay, which option says 3/8? Let's check. Oh my goodness. Raghav, you are right. For the first time today, you are right. Finally. Janta, how could you make this mistake? I mean, two people getting this right out of 15. No, it's not about I thought. Wrong is wrong. Full stop. How can everybody think like that? What do you think? I mean, this makes me doubt whether you have understood this whole game of addition theorem and conditional probability. Where is the doubt in this entire solution? Where is the disconnect? Where did you mess this up? People who gave it wrong, all the 13 of you gave it wrong. Can I know the reason why you got it wrong? Because very important for me to know the reason. It cannot be like, please don't do that. You are one of your seniors. No, very good. 99.56 percentile in JEE Main. Very disappointed he got 2,500 rank. He was aiming for under 1,000. You know what was his major regret? 5 questions, despite solving wrong, he wrote some different answer altogether. And that would be his regret for the whole of his life. He cannot go back and correct it. Unless until he writes JEE Advanced once more. JEE Advanced you can write twice. One in the appearing year and another in the drop year. Okay. So this silly mistake, this rushing through the question. My going to the washroom or mom calling. Okay, I hope that is true. But if you're rushing through it and you're, you know, getting it wrong, then again, it's going to be, you'll be regretting it. The least regret will be when you didn't know it and you got it wrong. And the most happiness is when you didn't know it and you got it right. Okay, so there are different phases of, see, it's all about your, there in corporate world, we are given a window. This is what you think you are and what does the world think about you. Okay. You think you are good. Maybe the world may be thinking you're bad, right? Here you think what you think. You think you're good. World also thinks you're good. Here is where you are bad, but world thinks you are good. Here you are bad. World also knows you are bad. So there are 4 windows of a person's character. For example, you are not good in mathematics and the world thinks you are good. So that means you fall under one of the windows where you are not good. So he himself was thinking whether we were thinking his rank is good or not, or he will be doing well or not. He himself was thinking I'll be doing good. So it depends upon the person's character. Okay, anyways, we'll take some word problems now. Yeah, everybody falls in some or the other line. Okay, let's take this question. I'll start with easier ones. I think these are all slightly heavier. It's a subjective question. I have no option given to you. So please solve this.
Give me a response in the chat box. Very good, very good, very good. Take the cheating one. Cheating is out of question in these exams. I mean, you're talking about the happiness part. Oh, there was a question based on cheating. Okay. Okay, so let's discuss it now. Two dice are thrown. Find the probability that sum of the numbers coming up on the dice is 9. If it is known that number 5 always occurs in the first dice, see, this is how you are supposed to read the question. So A is the event that the sum is 9. Okay. And B is the event that the first dice shows 5. Okay. You want the sum to be coming out to be 9. Okay, given that the first dice shows a 5. So basically, this is what you are looking for. Correct. As per the conditional probability, as per the multiplication theorem, this is the formula. Okay, now all of you please pay attention. Can I write this formula as this? Can I write it like this? Correct. See, ultimately, what is this? This is N A intersection B by N S. This is N B by N S. N S N S gets cancelled. So instead of calculating numerator probability and denominator probability, why don't you just count the events on the numerator and denominator and divide it? So this is another version of this particular formula. Note it down. So let us count those cases where you get sum of 9 also and first throw as a 5. So there's only one such case, where there is a 5 and there's a 4 coming up. So one out of, depends on one total number of cases, which I'm not worried about. But ideally, its probability is 1 by 36, isn't it? Okay. Anyways, in how many cases will you get a sum of 9? So 9 will come. The first thing is 3, 6, 6, 3. Correct? Yes or no? 4, 5, 5. 4, right? Anything else? Anything else that I'm missing upon? 5, 1, 1, 5. Oh, sorry. I want a sum of 9. I'm so sorry. Oh, sorry. I want the first number to be 5. Oh. B is the total number of cases where first number is 5. Okay. So then if this first number, I was counting something else. Thank you, Raghav. So if this is 5, this can be chosen in 6 ways. Okay. So this is 6. Answer is 1 by 6. Okay. Is it fine? Okay. Could I reverse the case and ask you, what is the probability that the first number shows a 5 given that the sum is 9? Yeah, so N A intersection B will not change. Now, how many ways can you get a sum of 9? That is what I was calculating. So I think there was only 4 such ways. 3, 6, 6, 3, 5, 4, 4, 5. Fine. Any questions? Good. Next.
An urn contains 3 white, 6 red, 4 black balls. Now, again, I'd like to repeat here. Unless until stated that the 3 whites are identical, you will not assume it to be identical. This mistake people do year after year. If they don't use the word identical, then these 3 whites, they are not identical. Just because they are of the same color, they doesn't make the balls identical. Okay. Those 6 reds, not identical. Those 4 blacks, not identical. Please don't make these mistakes, make these over assumptions. They will cost you the problems. If they are supposed to be identical, the question setter will write it. There are 3 identical white balls. There are 6 identical red balls. Like that he will mention. So from your end, please don't make them identical for God's sake. Should I put the poll for this as well? All right, I'm launching it. Very good. 3 of you have responded. Okay, last 30 seconds I can give you. So those who want to vote, please do so. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Okay, so I think good. People are still polling. Okay, I'll stop the poll now. Everybody's done? Okay, 17 of you have voted. Out of it, 65% say option B is correct. Okay. Let's discuss this question. See, first of all, what is a sample space? What are your events? So can I say there are two events here? One is you want one ball to be red and other to be white. Okay. And there's another event which says they are of different colors. Okay. Balls chosen are of different colors. Chosen balls are of different colors. Okay. What are we finding? Read the question. Question says, what is the probability of one ball being red and other is white? That is probability of A, given they are of different color. That means you are finding this. So the word given, the word if, they're all basically indicative that you are using conditional probability. So when extra information is only provided that the two balls that you have drawn, they are of different color, then what is the probability that one is red and other is white? Think like that. This is how it is, you know, to be perceived. So as per our multiplication theorem, this is PA intersection B by PB. Okay. Now you getting two balls of different color and you getting one red and one white. One red and one white is a subset of B, isn't it? So the intersection will be the subset only. So what is the chance that you get, what is the so let me write it in terms of numbers rather than probability. Why to waste time calculating the sample space when it is not required? Right? Why will you waste time finding sample space when it will get cancelled from the numerator and denominator? So out of six red, you want to pick up one white. So that is 6C1. And again, the fact that they were distinct, I could have used 6C1. I could not use 6C1 if they were identical. I hope you know your NCR definition very well. NCR means number of ways of choosing R objects from N distinct objects. Okay. Now, B is the other ball being, one is red and other is white. Other is white, there are three white balls, so you are choosing one out of it. Okay. Now, B is this event where you have two balls of different colors. So let's say one is red, one is white, which itself is written on the numerator, or one is red, other is black, or one is white, other is black. Sorry about that. One is white, other is black. Correct? That simply boils down to 18 by 18 plus 24 plus 12, which is 18 by, 40, 64. How much does it come out to be? 30 and 54. How much does it come out to be? 1 by 3, which is option number B. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns related to this question? Okay. Now, if you want to use PA intersection B, then all you need to do is divide the numerator and denominator by 13C2, because out of 13 balls, you're choosing two balls. But 13C2 eventually will get canceled off. Aditya, if they're identical, do we just take one of each? Yes. See, identical balls, if you pick any one of the balls, it is going to be taken care of the situation, right? So only one way to do it. Could you scroll high? I think this is the entire question, Shraddha. I mean, the entire solution and question is on the same page. Got it? Okay. See, when the balls will become identical, how would this question change?
So basically, in how many ways can you pick up? I mean, identical in every aspect, right? Identical in color and shape and sizes, that's it. I mean, exactly the same. So when you talk about picking up one red and one white, okay? So what is the chance that you end up picking one red and one white from this bag? Let's say I make it identical from every perspective. Everything will become 1-1-1, right? Yes or no? Correct. But here the problem will arise is there are Shitya Singh, ball of same color, identical. I mean, so ball of the same color are identical. Okay. So then white and red isn't a thing, right? Aditya has a question. Shouldn't we also take how like we are to get a white dough? See, in this case, what will happen is you getting a red ball will now be 3 divided by 13 actually. Because now they, sorry, 6 divided by 13. Because now there will be six red balls, that their numbers will be more. Correct. So PA intersection B will be what? 3 part will be what? See, you're picking 2 balls simultaneously. Correct. So what is the chance that one comes out to be red and other comes out to be blue? So picking up a ball simultaneously is like picking up 2 objects without replacement. So for PA intersection B, you'll have to take cases in that case. And in that case, your answer will be 6 by 13. And then you pick up a white wall, which will be 3 by 12. Or that is plus 3 by 13 into 6 by 12. No, Aditya, see, again, that's the point. If you're picking 2 balls together, it is like you picked one and within a fraction of a second, you have picked the next one also. So replacement cannot happen there. Your denominator is 13, 13 shows that there is a replacement back of the ball you have kept. That is not happening, no. Are you getting my point? So you are picking 2 balls and this thing can be perceived as if the first ball is a white and the second ball immediately is a red one, or the first ball is a red and the second ball immediately is a white one. So it would be, yes, Kinchuk, right? So it will be 6 by 13 into 3 by 12 plus the other way around also, 6 by 12. So into 2 it will happen. Correct. Same will go with the denominator also when you're trying to pick up 2 balls of different colors. So that problem will be much more, you know, complicated than this expression. Are you getting my point? It won't be like 1-1 and 1-1-1. It will not be like 1/3. All right. So last 7 minutes of our class, I would like to take one more question at least. What's this? Let's take this question. Huh? Yes. Something by 156 and all will come. 18 into by 156 will be the top case, and down also you have to take because it's a case of conditional probability. You're just talking about the numerator, I think, Kinshuk. Okay, let's read this question. The question says, a coin is tossed. if head appears, a fair die is thrown three times. Otherwise, a biased die with probability of obtaining an even number twice as that of an odd number is thrown three times. Okay, so there is a coin which is tossed. If head appears, a fair die is thrown three times. Tuck, 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 tuck. Okay. If a tail comes, then a biased die. And in this biased die, the chances of getting an even number is twice as high as getting an odd number, is thrown three times. N1, N2, N3 is the outcome. Okay. Of course, N1, N2, N3, they will all be between 1 to 6 only. And it is found to satisfy I to the power N1, I to the power N, so I is the imaginary part. Okay. This should be one. Why would denominator add up to one? Are they exhaustive events? That means you getting ball of two different colors. Is that an exhaustive event? Why I can't get ball of same color? So how they will not add to one. Ball of different color. No. Always different color you're taking. No, not add to one. Maybe. Or it is still coming out to be that. Okay. No, I'm talking to Aditya, not Kinshuk. Kinshuk, Aditya is saying that the answer is still coming out to be 1/3. As if we had used the same formula. Then I think logical wise, yeah, logic wise, it is correct. I think it is simplifying to that extent. Then it's. So yeah, Shitij also you're getting 1/3 only, right? Okay. Anyways, let's focus on this question. So you have to find out what is the probability that the dice thrown was a fair die. Okay, so this question is actually a Bayes theorem question, but again, Bayes theorem is a type of conditional probability. So I will try to discuss this with you in very simple way so that when we actually do the topic, you will feel connected to it. See, let us say I have the event E as the event where N1, N2, N3 are such numbers that they add up to give you a 1. Okay. And let's say even be the event that a fair die was thrown. event that a fair die was thrown to achieve it? Was thrown. Okay. E2 is the event that a biased die is thrown. Biased die is thrown. Biased thrown. First of all, related to biased die, they have given some information that the chances of you getting an even number is twice that of you getting an odd number. So let's say X is the chance of you getting an even number. And 2X is the chance of getting an even number, and X is the chance of getting an odd number. So either you get an even number or you get an odd number. So this will add up to give you 1. Correct. So X is equal to 1/3. Correct. Oh, sorry. I think there are 3 such even numbers and 3 such odd numbers. Sorry. X is going to be 1/9. I was thinking in terms of coins. It's a die actually, right? That means chance of you getting an even number. So chance of you getting an even number is 2/9, and chance of you getting an odd number is 1/9. Okay. Now, let's come back to the question. What is the question demanding from us? The question is demanding from us, what is the probability that the fair die was thrown? Okay. Given that this condition got satisfied. See, read the question. It is found that this result is 1. Then what is the probability that a fair die was thrown? So you are finding PE2/E1. Now, as per multiplication theorem, this is going to be this. Yes or no? Okay. Now let us focus on the denominator part first. What is the probability that if you're rolling 3 die, you are going to get N1, N2, N3 in such a way that i^n1, i^n2, and i^n3 will add up to give you a 1. Okay. So first of all, can we have the cases for N1, N2, N3 for this to happen? What all possible cases are going to occur? Tell me. Can I say if this is 2? Okay. And if this is 4, 4, it will happen because -1, 4, 4 will take care of it. So one combination is 2, 4, 4. Can I say other combination is 6, 4, 4? Even for i^6, it will be -1. Other will be +1, +1. Correct. Can I say it can be 1, 3, 4? Yes, 1 and 3, I and minus I will cancel each other out. And can I say it will be 3, 5, 4? Okay. Now I can always do a shuffling of it because all of them are, you know, symmetric expressions. So that I'm not worried about that as of now. Okay. Now you tell me, let us say I am throwing a fair die. Okay. Let's say I'm throwing a fair die. A fair die was thrown. Okay. First of all, what is the chance of you throwing a fair die? Half itself, because a fair die is thrown when you get a head. Okay. So first of all, the chance of you throwing a fair die itself is going to be half. Okay. Now, what is the chance that E will occur given a fair die has been thrown? Now, see, all of you, please pay attention to this. When a fair die is thrown,
You can have how many combinations of this? It can be 2, 4, 4, 4, 2, 4, 4, 4, 2, like that. So basically, can I say it will be 3C2 combinations? And fair die will give 1/6, 1/6, 1/6 for all these values that you will be getting. Right? See, basically what I did, getting a 2 is 1/6, getting a 4 is 1/6, getting a 4 again is 1/6, but they could be a shuffling of these positions, right? It could be 4, 2, 4, 4, 4, 2, and 2, 4, 4. So 3C2 such, you know, possibilities are there to get it. Okay. Similarly, this also, can I say 3C2 into 1 by 6, 1 by 6, 1 by 6? Why am I writing unnecessary brackets? Just to, yeah. 1 by 6, 1 by 6, 1 by 6. Here also all combinations, but now here, please note that this will be 3 factorial 1 by 6, 1 by 6, 1 by 6. Same goes with the last 3 factorial 1 by 6, 1 by 6, 1 by 6. Correct? Now let us talk about how do you get when a biased die is thrown. So first of all, the chance that a biased die will be thrown itself is a half, because biased die is thrown when you get a tail, when you roll a, when you toss a coin, isn't it? And how do you get E given a biased die has been thrown? Okay, so let's figure it out. The 3C2 part will be the same, I believe. But remember 3C2, you have all even numbers over here. So even numbers will be 2 by 9, 2 by 9, 2 by 9. Because in a biased die, the chances of you getting an even number is 2 by 9. Correct? Then again, same 3C2. Again, all of these are evens. So again, 2 by 9, 2 by 9, 2 by 9. Okay. Then the third case, 3 factorial. Now remember, 2 are odd and 1 is even. So this is 1 by 9, 1 by 9, 2 by 9. Same goes with 3 factorial. 2 are odd, 1 by 9, 1 by 9, and 4 is even. Okay. Now, all of you please pay attention. Coming back to this formula. This formula, I can write the numerator as PE1 into PE by E1. Or you can say this term, PE by E1. Am I right by multiplication theorem? So this expression by multiplication theorem, can I write it like this? Yes or no? Okay. And PE is the total number of ways in which you are actually getting N1, N2, N3 in such a way that I to the power N1, I to the power N2, and I to the power N3 is 1. So that is nothing but, listen to this, that is nothing but, it's going to be PE1 intersection E plus PE2 intersection E. Correct? Because you will end up getting that E scenario either with even in combination or with E2 in combination. That means either E1 occurs, that means you are throwing a fair die and that event takes place, or you are throwing the unfair die, which is the biased die, and that event taking place. In short, what you have written over here is, I'm just rewriting it once again, even though I'll be taking this subject matter in our Bayes theorem concept. So you are actually writing this. Okay. And all these values are very much known to us. PE1 is half. PE given even has occurred is this calculation. Can somebody do this calculation? Because I think it's not that difficult. 3C2 is 3. 3 plus 3 plus 6 plus 6 divided by 1 by x cube. I think this is going to give you 18. 18 is 3 into 6 by 6 cube. That's 1 by 12 if I'm not mistaken. So this part is 1 by 12. This numerator part, the other term is 1 by 12. Okay. So down here, this is also half into 1 by 12. This is half into, now let me calculate this term. This sum is 3 into 8, 3 into 8. So 2 into 3 into 8. And this is 6 into 2, which is 12.
again into 2 divided by 9 into 9 into 9. How much does it come out to be? I think it comes out to be 24 plus 48 is 72. 72 by 9 into 9 into 9, that's actually 8 by 81. Okay. So when you solve this, half half anyways gets cancelled off. So you'll end up getting 1 by 12 upon 1 by 12 plus 8 by 81. Let's simplify this. This will come out to be a very pathetic number, by the way. Let's do this one. 81 divided by 81 into 1 plus 96. So how much is this? 81 by 177. Okay, I think it'll go by a factor of 27 because this is 3, it'll go, right? So 3 by 59. 27 by 59. Okay, so this is the answer to this question. All right, now this question is not a difficult one once you learn the Bayes theorem. Actually, Bayes theorem is a special type of conditional probability where you cannot count these events. Okay, so here you have to stay with the formula. So this comes through the idea of total probability. So I should have taken this question after that, but I thought I would give you an idea of or the taste of total probability also. So don't worry, this is a concept where you are using total probability plus Bayes theorem, which I will take up tomorrow's session. Bayes theorem. Okay, we'll take this up tomorrow. See, when I say counting means you want to find out the total number of ways. Okay, you want to find out the total number of ways of doing that activity, which is associated with multiple events. Now you can count it. I'm not denying it, but I don't want to use that method because I can use my probability itself. See, the problem will come because of these, you know, these terms like 1 by 6, 2 by 9, 1 by 9, etc. Okay. Why do we need E1 and E2 for counting E? See, because Aditya, your event of getting N1, N2, N3 depends upon which type of die you are using, isn't it? So if you're using a fair die and you getting N1, N2, N3 in that file, in this particular, you know, fashion that condition is satisfied. That is a separate way of getting that, event E done. Another way of it is, let's say your initial die thrown was a biased one and then you getting it. So there are two ways in which you are accomplishing the task. So you have to add the total number of ways that you are trying to do the same activity because it is happening via different means. Tomorrow when we do total probability, you will understand the logic behind this. I will come back again to this question and try to explain you how is this working. Correct. Okay. Anyways, I think this was an overstretched class by 12 minutes and I didn't give you a break also. So enjoy, take a break, relax. Yes, I saw the plan. The plan was very good actually. Okay, thank you. Bye-bye, take care. This could be a JEE main exam. This could come in a JEE main exam. Yeah, Kshitij. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Yeah, highly. Thank you, everybody.